Hi everybody, welcome back to another video on the historical Jesus. These videos look at the evidence we have about Jesus from the first 2 centuries of the Common Era, and then ask a simple question. How can the historical Jesus theory account for these observations? We've already seen how the historical Jesus theory accounts for the appearance of Aramaic and Greek texts, why theologies about Jesus started with him being fully human, and only decades later did the idea emerge that he was co-eternal with Yahweh. Today we're going to look at some of the ideas about Jesus found outside the canon, so-called heresies, and what they believed about Jesus. But before that, I have to make a quick correction from the last video. I left out the Gospel of Mark story about Jesus' baptism being the start of his messiahship. I covered in the last video the adoptionist theology found in the pre-literary tradition in Acts of the Apostles, the idea that Jesus was adopted by Yahweh as his messiah at his resurrection. The Gospel of Mark has no birth narrative. Instead, the first appearance of Jesus is when he is put into the water by John the Baptist. According to Mark, it was at that moment that the Holy Spirit filled the man Jesus, and he was designated as the Messiah. To preview the conclusion of this video that we're about to go through, here are my main conclusions from the evidence we have. We see that Jesus was thought of as completely human from the earliest writings we have, and that this theology lasted for about 2 centuries. To mythicists, how do you account for this, and with what evidence? The only way I can see mythicists reconciling their ideas to the observable evidence is if they asserted that there was initially a core group who knew they had made up a fictional person and preached him as a myth, but that people who heard these stories within the first 30 years of the movement misunderstood their teachings and understood him to be a real person. That is really the only way I can see mythicists accounting for the theological obsession and heated debates over the nature of Jesus' body which were occurring in the 1st, 2nd, and 3rd centuries. Let's move on to the beliefs about Jesus not included in what became the Christian canon, but were popular with Christian believers in the early Christian movement. The information from this video comes primarily from the book Lost Christianities by Professor Bart Ehrman. In this video and the last, we were looking at the variation in what people believed about Jesus, what the word Messiah meant, and what his nature was. Was Jesus an ordinary human, or was he co-eternal with God? This debate lasted for centuries, and I gave a timeline of when ideas emerged over this time period. However, that's not to say that when an idea emerged, it immediately replaced the older ideas. From the observable evidence, we can see that the earliest idea about Jesus found in Paul and Acts, of him being human, persisted into the 2nd century of the Common Era. Mythicists aren't professional historians, and they also don't seem interested in advancing historical scholarship on our understanding of the early Christian movement. They don't really go into the debates that were going on about the nature of Jesus in the first 2 centuries, and if you read historical scholarship, the white-hot debates going on in the early Jesus movement focus on 2 main themes. Disputes over his nature, was his nature human or divine, and disputes over his body, was Jesus' body a human body or a divine body? We start with the Ebionites, and from the evidence we have, they preached the same theology we saw in the pre-literary tradition and Acts of the Apostles. They preached a Christology which understood Jesus to be human, the literal son of human parents. They rejected the idea that Jesus was divine entirely. Like Jesus, they kept the Jewish law and observances, and they identified themselves as followers of James, the brother of Jesus. Also, importantly, they rejected the Apostle Paul as a Jewish apostate, somebody who had abandoned the Jewish religion. Now, historical records on the Ebionites are scarce. Most of what we know about them comes from 2nd century Christian apologists who were condemning them as heretical Judaizers, a term that they used meaning people who believed that other people had to convert to Judaism in order to benefit in the coming kingdom of the Jewish God. That means for well over a century after Jesus' death, there were still Jewish followers who believed that he was an ordinary man who became the Messiah at his resurrection. Irenaeus stated that the Ebionites used Matthew's gospel, which if you know your Bible, you'll know is the most Jewish of the 4 gospels, and they used that one exclusively. Several historical scholars argue for some form of continuity from the Jewish Jerusalem church into the 2nd and 3rd centuries, and of course, Ebionites regarded James, the brother of Jesus, as their leader. Before we go further, I want to stop on this point of James, the brother of Jesus. We're going to hear his name appear again and again in the early Christian documents, and we've seen James listed as the brother of Jesus by independent sources of information. In a future video, I'm going to challenge mythicists to account for these writings that list James as the brother of Jesus. If Jesus never existed, how do you account for all of these independent observations listing James as the brother of Jesus? As I've said, there were many different ideas about the nature of Jesus in circulation that were being debated. On the other end of the spectrum from the Ebionites are various Gnostic beliefs about Jesus' nature. We saw last time in the Gospel of John that Jesus, while being more divine than any other version of Jesus in the New Testament, he's still a human being as well. In the same way that the Ebionites were considered heretics because they believed in Jesus' humanity, but not his divinity, Gnostics were generally considered heretics because they taught Jesus was mostly or entirely divine and not human. Contemporary scholarship largely agrees Gnosticism has Jewish or Judeo-Christian origins, and that it appeared in the late 1st century of the Common Era in both early Christian and non-rabbinical Jewish sects. Daryl Hannah notes that some early Christians understood the pre-incarnate Christ ontologically as an angel. This true angel Christology took many forms, and many have appeared as early as the late 1st century. Indeed, this is the view opposed in the early chapter of the Epistle to the Hebrews. The pseudographical, that means forgery, Christian text Ascension of Isaiah identifies Jesus with angel Christology. The Shepherd of Hermas is a Christian literary work considered as canonical scripture by some of the early church fathers, such as Irenaeus. And in it, Jesus is identified with angel Christology. In Parable 5, the author mentions a son of God as a virtuous man filled with a holy, quote, pre-existent spirit. Finally, I want to review another idea about Jesus that dealt with the nature of his body and whether it was human or divine. Apollinarism was proposed by Apollinaris, and he thought that Jesus could not have had a human mind. Rather, Jesus had a human body and a lower soul, which by that he meant the seat of the emotions, but that Jesus had a divine mind. What these views about Jesus' body and nature have in common is their late appearance. These ideas about Jesus' divine body or mind don't start appearing in the texts until some 50 to 60 years after his death. When we map theologies of Jesus on a timeline, the first beliefs we observe are that Jesus was a man who was raised by the Jewish God to be his Messiah. Theologies that thought Jesus was a divine being emerge much later. This observation can be accounted for if we take the premise of the historical Jesus theory that a man named Jesus actually existed. Now, mythicists, it's going to be up to you to articulate your theory and how it accounts for these same observations. Just to restate my challenge to mythicists, if Jesus never existed and people understood him to be a myth from the beginning of the founding of the religion, how do you account for the theological debates over the nature of Jesus' body, which we observe? Again, unless mythicists state that from the start, the people who were converted to the early Christian movement fundamentally misunderstood the original teachings were not based on a real person, and mistakenly thought he was a real person, I honestly don't see how mythicists can account for this timeline and the observations on it. Alright guys, thanks for watching. When I have time, my next intention is to do a video on James, the brother of Jesus. James is mentioned by Paul as being someone he met with in person due to James's role as the leader of the Jesus movement in Jerusalem, and James is mentioned by Josephus as being the brother of Jesus during a section of the history that he wrote. Proponents of mythicism start to develop your answers as to how a man who was supposedly a myth could have a physical brother who would meet Paul in person and be mentioned by a non-Christian, almost contemporary Jewish historian. Until then, I've been Christy, you've been awesome, thank you so much for your time and attention, and I will see you again very soon. Bye-bye.